Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Morning, everybody, and thanks for coming. God, it's a good group. I can hardly see it back there, but nice big group. And it's always so great to speak at YAF. You are really the people who can save the current generation, who can save our country and everything that we believe in, everything we've defended over the past 240 years. If you watched the debate last night, you know how necessary it is to have people like the people in this room to defend this country. We could be in big trouble. There's a real push towards leftist socialist ideology and economic principles that would really do great damage to this country. By the way, I want to congratulate, Scott Walker isn't here, but Governor Walker's a longtime friend. I want you to know you have a great, great leader for this organization now. YAF has always been a wonderful organization, but I think under Governor Walker that it will reach new heights. So, can anybody see, where are the slides? There they are. Okay, cool. Now I can see them too. This will help. In any event, while, as Mary mentioned, I was the CEO of CKE Restaurants, I did not grow up with a silver spoon in my mouth. I was a working class kid from a working class area in Cleveland, Ohio. My dad sold cars when I was a kid growing up in the 1950s and 1960s. My grandfather had come to this country as a teenager. He left his home, his family, his friends in the Austro-Hungarian Empire and came to the United States in 1912. Seeking freedom and opportunity like so many immigrants before him. But we were a working class, but you never thought about being a working class kid in the 1950s and 60s. Everybody seemed to be a working class kid. The kids on TV were working class, the kids at school were working class. You didn't think about class kind of the same way that people do today. It's just the way things were, at least for me. That was until I took a trip with my father, who came home one day and said, look, I've got a brand new car. I'm going to deliver it to this rich guy. His name's George Humphrey, who lives in Hunting Valley, which was just a few miles from our house, but it was really a different world. I didn't realize it at the time, but it was clearly a different world. And I said I'd go with him. So we went and pulled up to this huge, huge gate. Now, I'm 10 years old. I can't tell you how big the gate really was. In my memory, it's this huge, huge gate, but in reality, it could have been much smaller. It's probably the first house I ever saw with a gate. Anyway, the gate opens majestically, we pull in, and there's this beautiful, beautiful White House. It's sunset, you know, the sun is kind of shimmering off it, the landscaping's immaculate, the driveway's perfect, but my dad keeps driving. I looked over to my dad and I said, Dad, why didn't you stop? He looks down and said, son, that was the guest house. So we kept driving. We went by the stables, which were probably nicer than the, 1700 square foot ranch house that my father, my mother, my brother, my sister, and I lived in at the time. And we pulled up to this really enormous, at least in my memory, enormous house. It was kind of Downton Abbey big. Now, I don't know how big it really was. Again, I was 10 years old, but it seemed huge at the time. My dad walks up to the front. Mr. Humphrey answers the door. His father had been Secretary of the Treasury. This was a very well-to-do family. They talk for a little bit. They got along. And eventually, Mr. Humphrey hands my dad the keys to the trade-in. My dad hands him the keys to the new car. And we're walking back to the trade-in to drive home. And I'm looking around, and I am absolutely stunned by the wealth and the opulence that I'm surrounded by. I asked my father, I said, what does Mr. Humphrey do that he can live like this? My dad looked at me and said, son, he's a lawyer and he runs a business. And I can still remember thinking, a lawyer, I could be a lawyer. Now, I think it's good and important that I thought that, but I think it's more important what I didn't think. I didn't think that son of a bitch is stealing from us. he's in the 1%, and we're in the, whatever percent you're in when your father sold Fords in the 1960s. I didn't think that. What I thought was I could do that, and thank God, because my grandfather came to this country, I lived in a country where I would have the opportunity to, there was a path for me to become an attorney, eventually an attorney who ran a business. There was no path in the country my grandfather came from. There was a path here in the United States. And eventually, obviously, I did. I became an attorney who ran a company myself. When I ran CKE Restaurants, we had about 3,800 restaurants. I retired after 16 years, about 2 years ago. We had 3,800 restaurants in 45 states and 40 foreign countries, and we did about $4.3 billion a year in revenue. I lived the American dream. And the American dream exists because of capitalism. There isn't another country in the history of the world where a working class kid like me could have aspired to that level of success with any chance of actually achieving it. And the American dream exists because of capitalism. Had I been born in a socialist country, the idea of lifting myself from the working class, probably the working poor, to any other class would have either not occurred to me or would have seemed like an impossible dream. But you can do this in America, which makes it strange that today's youth wants to desert capitalism and embrace socialism. They seem to view capitalism as this oppressive economic system. You know, why would today's youth want to desert a system that's literally lifted billions of people out of poverty and created incredible opportunity across the globe and embrace a system that inevitably results in totalitarianism, poverty, and want? You know what, it wasn't so long ago, at least it didn't seem long ago to me, may seem long ago to you, in 1991, when the Soviet Union fell, and a lot of us thought socialism had finally been defeated, that it was proven to be a horrific economic system, the largest socialist economy in the history of the world, followed Marx's principles, collapsed of its own weight. You know, the joke at the time was that the only place you could find a socialist was the faculty lounge at Harvard. That's not true anymore. Socialism has made a comeback through the grandfatherly, you know, personality of Bernie Sanders, although he kind of reminds me of Larry David without the humor. He's just like, yeah, or the very charming Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. She is charming. She's very charismatic. There's a video of her dancing. You've probably seen it. She probably should stick with that. I felt better. I felt better after I saw the video than I felt before I watched it. I mean, she's a very charismatic young lady. So progressives are having a field day advancing the socialist notion that socialism is either necessary or desirable to protect the oppressed masses from capitalist greed. Now, that's a myth. It's not true, but today it seems to have very broad acceptance. Poll after poll shows us that millennials, the millennial generation, is very open to the notion of socialism and increasingly rejects the ideals of capitalism. Now, why would that be? Well, part of it is our education system. You know, we've got an education system that teaches leftist ideology as fact. The left has taken over the education system. And we've got an entertainment media complex that feeds America's youth leftist ideology as entertainment. But nobody ever tells millennials, nobody ever tells young people what socialism and capitalism actually are. There was a poll in last year by the Victims of Communism Memorial Foundation that found that 70% of millennials couldn't accurately define socialism or capitalism. So I like to start these events with a definition of socialism and capitalism. Now, most of you know the difference, but it doesn't hurt to repeat it because maybe there's a couple of people here who don't know the difference. So I start with socialism, which is an economic system under which the government controls, owns or controls, the building blocks of the economy, which are the means of production, distribution, and exchange. Now, the traditional socialism, they own it outright. More modern socialism, they just kind of control it through regulation, taxation, all the things that put the government in a very strong position. A capitalist economy is one where individuals control or own the building blocks of the economy. That's the basic difference. So I mentioned a myth. What's this myth I'm talking about? Well, the myth is that socialism is benevolent and capitalism is based on greed and avarice. It's just not true. Now, matter of fact, that whole notion came about early on in the debate between socialists and capitalists, but it was typified in a movie in the late 80s, the end of the Reagan administration, called Wall Street, where a character, you may have seen it, a character named Gordon Gekko is kind of the stereotypical Hollywood capitalist, and he's destroying companies and people, and you know, he's just running rampant over everybody. And he makes a comment in a lecture to his staff where he says, greed is good. Greed is good. I think that, and you know, that's Hollywood's idea of what capitalism's about. Greed is good. But outside of Hollywood, you know, greed is not good. And capitalism is not based on greed. In fact, it's just the opposite. And I'll prove it to you. The only way you can succeed in a capitalist economy, the only way, is by meeting the needs of other people. Your customers. When I ran CKE Restaurants, we didn't serve the burgers that Andy Puzder wanted or the burgers that some government elite wanted. We spent millions of dollars every year competing with all these other burger companies, trying to figure out what you wanted and how we could convince you that we had it at a price you could afford to pay. So what does capitalism do? It drives up quality. We tried to have the best quality. It drives down price. We tried to compete competitively. It drives up quality, drives down price. And if you don't convince people that you have what they need, they buy from somebody else, right? Think about, you know, Henry Ford. He didn't make Fords for kings and queens back in the early 1900s. He made them for the common man and the common woman. Steve Jobs, when he came up with the iPhone or the iPad, it wasn't for the government elites. It was for everybody. Everybody in this room probably has at least a smartphone, if not an Apple phone, or an iPad or something like it. This is because consumers control the economy in a capitalist system. It's a very democratic system. We all vote with every dollar we spend on which companies succeed and which companies fail. Now, it's very, very different so let me step back. So with capitalism, what you're doing is you're taking the desire each of you have to improve your life, and there's nothing wrong with that. That's why you get an education, that's why you get a job. Our desire to improve our life, and we expand it out to satisfy the needs of other people. That's how we improve our lives in a capitalist system. You know, not so in a socialist system. In a socialist system, you end up with a situation where everybody, you know, I always do this. Like if I don't check my slides on the deck here, I get two slides down in my speech and I have to go back. What we've got here is your local grocery store and the warehouse at Amazon and a shopping mall. Each of these pictures represents thousands of entrepreneurs trying to convince you that they have what you want at a price you can afford. That's how we end up with abundance, right? That's how we end up with abundance in a capitalist economy. Everybody's trying to convince you they have what you need. Again, taking that desire to improve your life and expanding it out to meeting the needs of other people. In a socialist economy, it's just the opposite. It takes and focuses your needs, your desires, your efforts in on you. You know, in a socialist economy, you are competing with every other person for the goods, services, or benefits that the government provides. For example, there's always a food line in socialist countries, right? Socialist countries never produce enough food to feed everybody. If you're standing in that food line, whether it's in the old USSR or today in Venezuela, you're not thinking about the person in front of you or behind you, right? You're thinking about how you can get the most for yourself when you get to the end of that line. This isn't about meeting the needs of other people, it's about meeting your needs. And whether you're waiting in line for gas or you're waiting in line for government rationed health care, what you want when you get to the end of the line is the most for yourself. You're not trying to find out what other people in that line need or want. And how do you get the most for yourself? How do you get more for yourself in a socialist country? Well, it isn't by meeting the needs of consumers who control the economy in a capitalist economy. It's by meeting the needs of the people who control the economy. If you meet the needs of the political elites in a socialist economy, you can get more for yourself or your family. So everybody's out there trying to meet the needs of the people at the top, and then you've got huge masses of people that really are oppressed masses starving. This is the case in every socialist country, whether it's Cuba, North Korea, Venezuela, the former USSR. You know, just think about it for a minute. Think about North Korea, right? They don't have any consumer goods. They don't have enough food. There isn't enough health care. Everybody always runs out of toilet paper in these socialist countries. Did you ever notice that's one of the first things that goes is toilet paper? Everybody's starving, except the political elites. Look at Kim Jong-un. Does it look like this guy's missed a meal lately? Seriously. You know, or Venezuela. In Venezuela, illness is rampant. I mean, they're afraid to let people into Colombia or Brazil because all these diseases that we thought were wiped out in that part of the world are resurfacing. You know, people are starving to death. They can't get medical care for their kids. They're eating their pets. They're literally eating their pets, reported in the New York Times. You know, does it look like Maduro and his buddies are eating their pets? You know, they're not. And the interesting thing with Venezuela is that it sits on an ocean, literally an ocean of oil. Venezuela has the largest proven oil reserves in the world, more than Saudi Arabia, more than Russia, more than the United States. But they're starving. The people are starving. This is the benevolence of socialism. This is what socialism does. Inevitably, wherever it's tried, it creates poverty and want. Unlike capitalism, which wherever it's tried, produces prosperity and abundance. Now, to hide this, the socialists today have to hide this. You know, Bernie Sanders is probably the leader in this. He was out beginning in 2016 saying, you know, we're not that old kind of socialism. We're this new democratic socialism. Now, he never said, you know, democratic is like, it's like calling it, you know, soft and pliable socialism. It's something to try and make it sound nicer, because socialism is a word that people, at least from my generation, associate with poverty and oppression. They go out and they say, we're Denmark, right? That's who we are. We're not those old socialists, we're Denmark. Well, there's a problem with that. The problem is that Denmark is a free market capitalist economy. There was you know, back in 2016 when Bernie was running around, by the way, Bernie put me on his list. I don't know if you see this enemies list that Bernie put out. He actually put me down as number 3 on his enemies list. That's the only I promise that's the only thing I'll brag about this morning. I really feel good about that. The prime minister, Lars Loki Rasmussen, came to the United States, spoke at Harvard. And what the Danes were kind of irritated because they didn't like being told they were socialist. So he came to the United States and he said, I know that some people in the U.S. associate the Nordic model with some sort of socialism. So he wasn't just talking about Denmark. He's talking about Sweden, Norway, all the Nordic countries. He says, therefore, I would like to make one thing clear. Denmark is far from a socialist planned economy. Denmark is a market economy. You know, so you don't have to take my word for it. The Danes will tell you that they're not socialist. And there is a survey that comes out every year. It's put out by the Heritage Foundation. You may have heard of it. It's called the Index of Economic Freedom. It ranks 180 countries in the world from most economically free to least economically free. Last year, Denmark ranked number 14. I mean, this is not a socialist planned economy. Just to give you some perspective on that, the United States was number 12. You know, they're almost as economically free as we are. Now, you can argue about it. They do have a very generous social welfare system. And you can argue about whether or not that's a good thing or a bad thing, because some people claim that these extensive social welfare systems, they cause you to overtax people, they discourage work, they discourage people from getting ahead and succeeding in their own lives, which makes for unhappy people. And you can debate that. In fact, the Danes have been debating it for years and have cut back on their social welfare benefits and reduced their taxes so people could take home more of what they earn. But the reality is only a capitalist country could fund these social welfare programs. Denmark has to be a capitalist economy, otherwise they couldn't have these programs because there wouldn't be any money to fund them. Socialist countries always promise these programs, but they're never able to pay for them. All right, so socialism produces poverty and want. Capitalism produces prosperity and abundance. But does it reach down to the common man and the common woman? Are we really talking about lifting people from the bottom, or are we just talking about a bunch of robber barons that make a bunch of money at the top? To discuss that, I want to show you a chart, and it's been called by Jonathan Haidt. I don't know if you know who he is. He's with NYU, an incredible, incredible guy, an economist, good guy. But he calls this the most important chart in the world. It comes from research by a British economist, historical economist named Angus Madison, who studied the history of economics going back really to the year zero, so about 2,000 years of economic history. And this is a graph that he produced, or the Angus Madison Project produced. He died in 2012. It first appeared in the Atlantic magazine, and it measures the world's economic growth through something called GDP per capita. Now, most of you probably know this because it's an educated group, but GDP is just economic growth, right? It's economic productivity. So you're talking about economic productivity per capita, which obviously means per person. And so this measures economic production per person. Why don't they just call it that? Why do they call it GDP per capita? I think it's just because economists like to sound smarter than they are. But it's economic activity per person going back to the year zero. And as you can see, something really happened around the year 1800. If you ran a company and this was your sales chart, right, you'd be getting ready to retire. I mean, this is talk about a hockey stick chart. We had something happened in the world around 1800. Now, I showed this to a millennial son of mine. He'll be 27 next month. I showed it to him a couple years ago. And having a degree in finance and working at an investment banking firm, he told me, "Dad, you're going to tell me this is capitalism, but really it's mostly just the Industrial Revolution. This wasn't capitalism." So I had to show him another chart. This is the second chart, which breaks down that big jump up. This spreads out that 200-year period where we saw the huge rise and makes it a little easier to understand. You can see where, by region of the world, we had this incredible economic growth all of a sudden. It happens first in the United States. Why? Well, because in 1776, we had two fortuitous coincidences. One was the Declaration of Independence, and the other was the publication of a book called The Wealth of Nations by Adam Smith, which described how you would set up a modern capitalist economy and why you would want to. Well, we did. We adopted a modern capitalist economy, and we turned 13 backwoods colonies on the coast of North America into the world's largest economy in less than 100 years. From the time we ratified our Constitution in 1789 until 1885, over that period of time, we went from nothing to the world's largest economy, larger than the economy of what was then called Great Britain, on which the sun never set. They had the whole world almost as a colony. We surpassed them, and we've never looked back. What about Great Britain? They had an Industrial Revolution, and you can say they got something of a lift. They also had a little bit of capitalism mixed in there, but they had an Industrial Revolution. Then they shoot up. When do they shoot up? They shoot up after World War II. What happened at the end of World War II? Well, the fall of the National Socialist Party. Who were the National Socialists? That's exactly right. Somebody had an education in high school. That's a rarity nowadays. Somebody actually knew the history here. That was the Nazi Party. Japan shot up after World War II. What happened? Well, Douglas MacArthur, General MacArthur, went in and set up a capitalist, free market democracy. Japan actually went up and exceeded Western Europe for the first time in history. Even China goes up. Eastern Europe goes up. What happened there? Fall of the Soviet Union in 1991. China shoots up. What happened in China? They instituted something called red capitalism. It isn't even real capitalism. And they still took a bump up, right? I mean, this is pretty incredible. This, unquestionably, what happened here was due to the implementation of free market capitalist policies across the planet. They work. But do they reach down? Do they reach to people that are impoverished? What about the poor of the world? Are we really helping, you know, the people that are starving, the people that are living in abject poverty? Now, you saw at the beginning, this last graph, that, you know, there were a lot of poor people up until 1800, right? I mean, nobody had any money other than the exceptionally wealthy, the aristocracy, the emperors, the kings, the queens. So the World Bank, which is a bank located in Europe that makes loans to countries, particularly developing countries across the planet, did some research back a few years ago looking at how extreme poverty has increased or decreased going back to the year 1820. So just about the time that real jump up starts in GDP per capita. And they found back in 1820 that 94 out of every 100 people, in other words, 94% of people were living in extreme poverty. Not just regular poverty, it's like extreme poverty, right? The six that weren't living in extreme poverty, two or three of them were probably living in regular poverty. You know, if you don't believe a lot of people were living in poverty, read a book by Dickens. I mean, the situation was bad back then. By the time you got to 2015, that number was down to 10. 10 people out of every 100. Now, 10 is still too many. We don't want anybody living in extreme poverty. But it's important that we understand what caused the reduction, right? We have to know what caused the reduction to continue that reduction. So I had a techie buddy of mine put together the chart on the acceleration in GDP per capita and the decline in people living in extreme poverty. I had him take the data from those and put it together to see if there was a correlation. Two different sources, so I didn't know if they'd correlate or not. And this is a chart you won't see anyplace else because my buddy didn't give it to anybody else. And here's the correlation. He said he'd never seen a correlation that close. As GDP per capita came down, the money was reaching people at the bottom. It was reaching people living in extreme poverty. This is what capitalism does. Yeah, feel free to take a picture of it. I'm not keeping this to myself at all. I want everybody to see it. This is an incredible correlation. This is what capitalism does. This is the benevolence of capitalism. Here's another chart by a Swedish historian. I think this is my last chart, so I don't want any people falling asleep. Some of you probably just woke up. This is a chart that took that World Bank data. It was by a Swedish historian, and he looked since the fall of the Soviet Union, what's happened in the country with respect to hunger, poverty, illiteracy, child mortality, and pollution. And you can see they've dropped like a rock as the world's largest socialist economy disappeared, and the second largest socialist economy, China, switched to red capitalism. Less hunger, less starving children, fewer starving children, less poverty. Look at that poverty line. It just drops like a rock. Child mortality, fewer hungry kids, fewer kids that are dying, less poverty, more prosperity, lower pollution, higher literacy. This is the benevolence of capitalism. This is what capitalism does. Just the opposite of what socialism does. Now, why does this happen? Well, the reality is that you take people's desire to improve their lives, as I said, and you focus that out. You focus that out, and it generates incredible energy. You know, part of the socialist ideology, the socialist notion, is that wealth is a zero-sum game. It's not something you can produce more of, but it's a zero-sum game. What do I mean by that? I mean, the rich only get richer when the poor get poorer, or the poor only get richer if the rich get poorer, which is why you attack the 1% and say we have to take money from them and give it to poor people. The reality is that with capitalism, everybody becomes better off. And the person who expressed that the best, I think, of anybody was a president named John F. Kennedy, who was a Democrat. He was actually running for president when my dad and I went and visited Mr. Humphrey, so that's how long ago that was. But he made a comment during his campaign that a rising tide lifts all boats. What did he mean by that? Well, he was arguing for tax cuts. President Kennedy implemented, it didn't happen until after he was assassinated, but he introduced the bill, was promoting it very heavily to generate economic growth. He wanted big tax cuts, and eventually he got the big tax cuts, and they did produce economic growth. But his point was that if you have economic growth, if you have a free market capitalist economy, that rising economic tide lifts everybody. It lifts the rich, the poor, the middle class, the upper class. Everybody benefits when you have a free market capitalist economy and entrepreneurs generating wealth. And you see that today. You know, we've seen President Trump come in, cut taxes, reduce regulations, and focus on domestic energy production, completely reversing the policies of the Obama administration. Now, it is kind of funny now to hear people say, well, this economic recovery, it's all just continuation of what Obama did. So what they're saying is that Apparently, Obama had these great economic policies. They just waited until President Trump was elected to have any impact. And only after he cut taxes, reduced regulation, and focused on domestic energy, basically reversing all of the policies, then they had an effect and drove economic growth. I mean, it's a nonsensical position. Since President Trump's election, with those economic policies, we've seen the United States. This is a graph put out, an analysis put out by the World Economic Forum. That's, again, a group in Europe. You've probably heard they meet in Davos every year. They rank the most competitive countries in the world. Thanks to President Trump, we are the most competitive country in the world for the first time since 2008. As I've said, we've gone from number 18. Wait, I didn't tell you this. We were number 18 on the list of the freest economies in the world. Remember, I told you Denmark's number 14 now. We were number 18 when President Trump took office. We were number 5 when President Obama took office. We're now number 12. We moved from 18 to 12. So we're moving in the right direction for sure. And then one more graph to make the point. I guess I lied when I told you there were no more graphs. This is a graph that just came out by Bloomberg, and it's a startup barometer, and it shows you how many tech startups there's been. And they use deal count, financing, you know, exit count. They balance it all out. You can see where President Trump was elected. Do you notice a difference? These are the people that claim, right, that Obama is really responsible for the current economic surge. Look what's happened with new tech companies in the United States since the presidential election. So is the Trump boom reaching people other than the very wealthy? You'll hear that tax cuts were just for the wealthy under Trump, et cetera, et cetera. Well, in fact, we have more people working in the United States today than we have in the history of the country, 157 million people. We have under 6 million people employed for the last 3 months, each of the last 3 months. And by the way, we haven't had under 6 million people unemployed since 2001. That's 18 years ago. And 18 years ago, there were 20 million fewer people in the workforce to be unemployed. It's an incredible number. We've seen unemployment below 4% for 16 straight months. The last time that happened was 1969. I was 19 years old, and my hair was down to here. Just to let you know how long ago that was. We've seen historical lows in unemployment for African Americans, Hispanics, women, people with only a high school education, the handicapped, veterans. Everybody's experienced historically low unemployment rates over the past year. When President Trump took office, we had 2.1 million more people unemployed than there were job openings. In May, we had 1.4 million more job openings than we had people unemployed. In other words, if every one of those 6 million people took a job today, we'd still have 1.4 million job openings. What does that do? It drives wages, because you've got employers competing for employees. When employers compete for employees, wages and benefits go up. When employees are competing for jobs, as they did during the Obama years, wages and benefits go down, right? Makes perfect sense. It's supply and demand. We just had a report out 2 days ago from the Bureau of Economic Analysis showing that wage growth was 5.5% year over year in June. That's a huge number. Everybody had been very excited because the Bureau of Labor Statistics, a separate government entity, had reported 11 straight months of 3% plus wage growth, right? The last time we had 3% plus wage growth was 10 years ago, right at the beginning of the Obama administration. Since then, we've had nothing close to it. Now we've had 11 straight months. To give you an idea, to try and take those percentages and keep you awake a little bit, just to let you know what those numbers really mean, for the first six months of 2019, we've had $150 billion more of an increase in personal income than we had for the entire year of 2016. The economy is on fire. Now, unless you read the Wall Street Journal, you're not going to read much of that, but it's absolutely the case. So what's happened over the last 2 years? Well, we've actually gone from an economy where just 2.5 years ago, the biggest problem we were facing was too many unemployed people and not enough jobs, to an economy where the big problem we're facing is businesses can't find enough qualified people to fill the jobs that are open. That, I called that the capitalist comeback in my book. By the way, the paperbacks out there, they called the paperback the Trump boom because the publisher thought it would sell more books, I think. I called the book the capitalist comeback because I thought that was really what emphasized the point of the book. But you've really had this incredible turnaround in the economy. Now, what does this mean for you people? What does it mean for young people? Well, actually, it means a lot, because I think, just like any other generation, your generation wants to see, you want to do well, you want to see people around you do well. You want to see the poor and the underprivileged do well. And the good news is, I have great news for you. The economic system under which you were raised, the economic system which is your legacy, is the greatest economic system ever devised. And it is the one system that has a real potential to create those opportunities for you and for the people around you. Our economic system encourages our farmers to grow the food that feeds the world, because by feeding the world, they can better feed themselves and their families. It encourages entrepreneurs to tear down, you know, devastated buildings in neighborhoods in the inner cities and revitalize those areas of the cities with, you know, new restaurants, new hotels, new grocery stores, because by serving their communities, by benefiting their communities, they can better benefit themselves and their families. It is the best system ever devised for the poor and the marginalized. Right? It empowers them as consumers who vote with every dollar they spend. So our attention is focused on them as consumers. It creates the opportunities that can lift them from the working class to any other class they choose to go to. That system's called capitalism. It's your heritage, it's your legacy. And whether your generation decides to defend it or decides that they will let our personal liberties and our economic freedoms fade in exchange for the proposed benefits of socialism, that's completely up to your generation. As Ronald Reagan said it best, and he said a lot of things best, but in particular, he said this. He said, freedom is only one generation, always, only one generation away from extinction. And whether you guys are that generation, whether your generation makes that choice or not, is completely up to you. It's your call, it's your decision. My generation and people like myself can, you know, all we can do is try and spread the word and spread it to people like you who will spread it. I pray that God will bless you in your efforts. I pray that God will bless every one of you, and that God will continue to bless the United States of America. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. And I did not keep, I guess I have 7.24 minutes left to take questions, and I'm willing to answer questions as long as they let me take them.
My name is Will from Marymount University. Thank you for that speech. That was incredible.
Thank you.
We've heard from a couple different speakers. Governor Walker is in favor of a balanced budget amendment. Walter Williams is in favor of cutting spending as a proportion of the GDP that we take in as taxes. I just kind of wanted to get your view on how we're going to cut the deficit and deficit interest over the next couple of years, because we know it's going to seriously affect our generation sometime in the future.
Yeah, if we keep the Democrats in the House of Representatives, if we keep at least a third of the Senate populated with Democrats, it will be very, very difficult to balance the budget. You probably don't know this because nobody's reporting it. I'm going to wait till the end of the fiscal year to write about it. But with the tax cuts, you know, you're hearing about how they're not paying for themselves, they're supposed to pay for themselves. Well, actually, tax revenue is up 8% from the last year that we didn't have tax cuts. You know, that's 2 years ago. If inflation is 2% a year, that's 4% inflation, you're still up 4% in tax revenue. We don't have a revenue problem, we have a spending problem. And 70% of our spending is on entitlements. Now, does that mean we have to push Granny over a cliff? I don't know if you ever saw that that video they did of Paul Ryan pushing an elderly lady over a cliff. Look, we need to reform Social Security. I'm entitled to it. Why the hell do I need Social Security? Seriously. I mean, you know, I know I paid into it. And the retirement age, there's a lot of things we could do that would make these programs more sensible that would reduce their cost. We need to do that. But with Democrats in the House and Democrats in the Senate, you really can't get it done. So I'm hoping that in this election, and I'm very encouraged by the debates. You know, I think that the party of, you know, socialism, open borders, anti-Semitism, and infanticide is probably not the party that's going to win the election. So I'm hopeful that we'll do well in this election. But we do have to cut spending. Right now we're okay. We have GDP is enough. You know, we can maintain this for a while, but we can't maintain it forever. Just like a rich person couldn't spend, you know, tremendously more than what they're worth and expect to survive. So we need to cut.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kitty Fields. Hi. I go to George Mason University. So George Orwell, the author of many books that are popular reading among conservatives, was a socialist. So can you explain the difference between his brand of socialism and the socialism that the left is pushing now?
I never really thought of, when you read Animal Farm, it's hard to think of Orwell as a socialist because he really kind of lays out what would happen if you tried to run a farm, if the animals got to run a farm like a socialist commune. But I think the big difference between traditional socialism and today's socialism is that under traditional socialism, they advocated that government would own the means of production, distribution, and exchange. Now, they just wanted to control the means of production, distribution, and exchange. So under one system, you wouldn't be able to control what you produced, how much you produced, what you were paid, what you paid your employees, when you paid your employees. And under the new form of socialism, you wouldn't be able to control what you produce, when you produce, how much you produce, what you pay yourself, and what you pay your employees. I really don't see a big actual, in-practice difference between what Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren are talking about and what Karl Marx and Lenin talked about. I mean, I think they're really pushing for the same thing, which is empowering government because they trust elites, which is weird because elites always make the wrong decisions. Well, they trust elites to make decisions for the economy more than they trust all of us as consumers to guide those decisions. And I think that's just wrong thinking, no matter whether you call it democratic socialism or communism or traditional socialism, you end up with the same result. You end up with poverty and want. You end up with people starving.
My name is Nicholas Trush from High Point University.
Hey, Nicholas.
My question is, the Federal Reserve voted and passed the vote to lower the federal interest rate from 2.5% to 2.25% as of yesterday. How do you think that's going to impact small businesses as a whole in the economy?
Well, only marginally. They really should have taken it down half a point. I think where they messed up, you know, if you probably know the history of this, but during the entire Obama administration, for 8 years, they raised interest rates once in 2015. The stock market crashed, and they pulled back. And they said, okay, we're not doing that again. And the stock market went back up. The next time they raised interest rate was after Trump was elected, December of 2016. And they raised it 8 quarters in a row. We had tremendous economic growth despite the first 6 increases. We had, 4.2% second quarter of 2018, then 3.5%. But they raised it when they raised it in September of 2018 and then again in December of 2018, they screwed up. They pushed the markets beyond what they were willing to accept, and they pushed the economy beyond what it could rapidly absorb. Nothing wrong with interest rates going up, but you got to take them up slowly. You can't take them up all at once or you discourage growth. So I think taking it down to 0.25 will make a difference in a number of ways. One is it will help to weaken the dollar. And you might think, well, why would you want to weaken the dollar? Well, the reason is so that people overseas can buy our goods and generate more manufacturing and more jobs in this country. When the dollar is strong, it's harder to purchase American goods than when the dollar is weaker. When we're the only really strong economy in the world, I mean, Europe is faltering, even Germany, China, they say they have 6% GDP growth, which is way down for them. I'll bet it's more like 1% GDP growth. They never tell the truth about their economy. I think when we are the only, you know, they say in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. Well, we're the two-eyed man in the land of the blind. I mean, our economy is doing extremely well while the rest of the world isn't. Having a strong dollar just makes it more difficult for people to purchase our goods. So I think it will have an effect on the economy. I think it was the right thing to do. I just don't think they did enough.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
My name is Patrick Warren. I'm from Utah. So you pointed out that the United States has climbed to number 12 on the index of economic freedom. I think Hong Kong is number one.
Hong Kong's number one. Taiwan's number, or Singapore's number two.
Yeah, I think, and I think you'd agree, it's a tragedy what's happening with Hong Kong.
It's a disaster.
But do you think that the United States, or at least as conservatives, should we push policies that get us to number one, especially considering that when the Democrats take back control, they'll bump us down a few spots?
Well, I think we should do everything we can to be number one, because I think people notice the difference. Most of you, if you were alive, you were very young. But before Ronald Reagan, we were in a very depressed economy. Things were terrible. Reagan came along and showed the American people what you can do with conservative economic policies. And that lasted really through the George W. Bush administration. Bill Clinton came in and tried to do some leftist type economic policies. And then, you know, I don't know, he's got a very famous State of the Union address where he got up after two or three years of trying that and said, you know what, it didn't work. The age of big government is over. And had to actually kind of step into Reagan's shoes. He ended up reforming welfare. He deregulated banks. He cut capital gains taxes. So really that Reagan impact lasted about 20, 25 years until the election of Barack Obama. So what the Democrats fear, you know, the Democrats fear with Trump isn't that he'll fail. The Democrats fear with Trump is that he'll succeed like Reagan succeeded, and it's going to be another 20, 25, 30 years before they can convince the American people that these idiotic socialist ideas or left-wing ideas are in any way viable. So I think there's a big fear out there that he'll be successful and that they won't be able to implement those policies until people forget. Socialists think very long term. They love government, they advance government, they do everything they can to promote government. You know, we do the opposite. We promote individuality, we promote personal freedom, personal liberty. We don't like government, and therefore they get control of the government over a period of time. But they're very afraid of this president, as you can tell by if you watch TV at all or go on the internet.
Thank you.
Thanks. I have zero time. Are they going to let me keep going? I can't see. Nobody's stopping us, right? Okay.
Hi, my name is Zach Pugh. I'm with the University of Mississippi. Do you think the draw towards socialism that we have seen recently, do you think that comes from a general sense of good intentions, a sense of the want for control, or for something else?
Well, I think your generation has been taught, and like I said, I've got three. My youngest son is 21 years old. So, I mean, I've got three sons that are at or close to your ages, and they were taught in school that, you know, that socialism is very benevolent and that capitalists are greedy pigs. And so I think that the tendency is to be open to the ideas of socialism, and it does sound good. It does sound like you'd have these benevolent people, you know, who would be running everything and making all these good decisions, but it just never works. It's not a system that ever actually functions that way, as the people in Venezuela, North Korea, and Cuba would attest to today. So I think it's the education system, and I think it's the entertainment industry, as I said. It's hard to watch anything anymore because it's all so leaning towards the left. You almost have to ignore it to have any form of entertainment, unless you go on online and watch videos from YAF or PragerU or something. You're in trouble.
Thank you.
Hi, Mr. Puzder. My name is Austin.
Hi, Austin.
I'm a physics and economics major at the University of Virginia.
You're much smarter than me.
And I've heard a lot in the mainstream media, and you kind of even spoke a little bit about it today, about our economy is on fire. Some even say it's overheating. And I want you to comment on the idea of overheating. That's never made sense to me. Can an economy grow too quickly in terms of real GDP per capita, not inflation?
Well, if you grow, the worry with growing too quickly is that you know, you're going to have a big fall. We will eventually have a recession. By the way, we will have a recession. We always have recessions. Economy can't grow like this. It grows like this. It's like a sawtooth aimed up. It's not a straight line going up. And the concern is that if you go up too high, you'll come down too low. I think that, you know, we've seen that in the past with bad policy. So I think the concern is you don't want it to grow too fast, but it can sure grow faster than it is. It was, you know, thanks to the Fed, I believe, the Fed's actions last September and December, We had 2.1% GDP growth last quarter. Now, I think it's going to be better in Q3, but I think they slowed it down too much, and they should back off and try and be less of a dampening. We had 8 years under Obama where GDP growth never really got above 2%. You know, it's time. We need, and now we're having the GDP growth, and the benefits are getting to the people that we want to help. They're getting to working class Americans. For God's sakes, let them benefit for a while before you kill the economic growth. So I think it's, I don't think we're overheating, but it is a danger. We need to keep an eye on it.
Thank you.
Sure.
Good afternoon, Mr. Puzder. My name is Michael Getman. I'm Director of Development for the Virginia Tech YAF. In the capitalist comeback, you rail against Woodrow Wilson as the first true progressive president. And we meet a lot of IR majors as a poli-sci major who worship the ground that Wilson walked on, say he was one of the greatest presidents ever. How do we combat the myth of Wilson as one of the best presidents when in reality he was a complete and total disaster?
I mean, what do they use to advocate for him? If you look at the comments he made, particularly prior to becoming president, he was actually the second progressive president. The first was Teddy Roosevelt. But he was the one that laid the groundwork for Roosevelt's election. And then because Roosevelt, he's kind of a fun president to watch. He was entertaining. But he actually killed the Republicans. He's the reason that Wilson became president, because he ran as a third-party candidate. Wilson would not otherwise have been elected. But if you look, Wilson hated the Constitution. He thought the founding fathers were misguided. He was not a fan of our individual liberty and economic freedom. And you can, I point out some of the major faults with his reasoning in the book. And it all depends upon how they try to defend him, because other than we won World War II while his wife was running the country, I don't know what defense there is. Or World War I, excuse me. I'm like Joe Biden. They won World
War. Thank you very much, sir.
Mr. Buster.
Yes.
My name is Alex Flynn. I'm a junior at the University of Mississippi. My father actually texted me during your speech. He went to school with your son, Christian, in Clayton, Missouri.
That's great. Christian's now the CEO of a tech startup, my 45-year-old son. Yeah.
My question is, I'd like to build on the gentleman from the University of Virginia. In terms of an economic recession, have you noticed any signs of a recession in the near future?
No. In fact, there's when they tell you there's a coming recession, there's something you can do. It's called St. Louis Fred. It's the St. Louis Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis. Go St. Louis Fed recession probability. They publish a chart which is based on an analysis that's been very accurate at predicting when recessions are coming. If the recession probability is under 20%, a recession is very unlikely. If it's over 80%, a recession is very likely. As of the most recent analysis, which was July 1st, it was at 0.98%, less than a percent. We're not heading towards a recession. Will there be a recession? Yes, there will be a recession. If people are out there predicting it, they are absolutely right. There will be a recession. Are we going to have one anytime soon? No, we're not.
Thank you, sir.
My name is Jacob. I'm the president of the YAF Club at Oxford University.
Great.
And I'm wondering what your opinion is on China. When the Soviet Union fell, we went and embraced China. All the Western nations did. If we had not done that, would it have been better off, and would China be more prosperous and much better of an ally now?
No, what we did with China was part of a policy that we implemented after World War II. After World War II, we were the only country in the world that didn't have its manufacturing and agricultural industries destroyed, decimated. We were the only really first world country that was able to produce goods, produce food. So we were the king of the country, we were the king of everything, and we gave very good trade deals to other parts of the world to help revive their economies. We had the Marshall Plan in Europe. When Nixon went to China, we changed our policy with China to try and lift them, because we believed that prosperous countries would not be a threat to us, that we wouldn't end up at war with these other countries. The policies were very successful. The problem is now GDP in the European Union is actually higher than GDP in the United States. They don't really need these good trade deals anymore. So when you can buy a Mercedes in Detroit, and Mercedes only paid a 2.5% tariff. But if you buy a Ford in Berlin, you have to pay, you know, Ford paid a 10% tariff. That's just not fair. And same with China. China doesn't really need our help anymore. They have an economy that's the second largest in the world right now. European Union, you know, is obviously broken up by countries, so it's not judged on a collective basis. But if you look at countries, China's number two. They don't need our help anymore, and it's time to step back. They shouldn't be able to steal our intellectual property. They shouldn't be allowed to hack into our computer systems. They shouldn't have these restrictive deals where we can't do business in their country unless we get Chinese partners. They shouldn't have a 25% tariff on automobiles as opposed to our 2.5% tariff. So what President Trump's doing is absolutely right. China, I think China would not be as well off today if we had not allowed them to do what they've done up to now. But keep in mind, China's a very developed country, but they are a very poor country. GDP per capita, right, economic growth per person, is about $10,000 in China. It's the same in Greece and Romania. And if you look at their neighbors in Taiwan, GDP per capita is $26,000. In South Korea, it's $32,000. In Japan, it's $41,000. In Hong Kong, it's $49,000 per person. So they're surrounded by capitalist free market economies. And the Chinese people travel, they know that they're not getting a very good deal with their current economic system. So it's been good for us to try and help elevate them, and they now are up to a 10,000 per person GDP. But you know, it's going to take them, you know, take them a century to catch up to the United States. We're at $62,000 per person. So I think that it was good that we helped China, but we're done now.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. I hope you enjoy the conference. It's been a pleasure. It's been a pleasure presenting. I'm happy to sign books out there, assuming that they're changing my plane reservation, because the one I currently had, I'd get home next week. They're trying to change it now. If they didn't change it, so if I have time, I'll sign books. Otherwise, I hope to see you at a conference in the future. Thank you very much. Oh, thank you.